bumping red there for a second.
Oh, a good connection.
It's still on like a
30 seconds.
Yeah, I know it's a big delay, but I thought I heard this or it's coming. Hear me. That's not it.
Testing. We are here at Blue Jay Stadium in Fulton, Missouri for today's soccer action. Sounds good.
I mean, I can still hear, but when you were talking in your mics, it came through.
Oh, great.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah, thank you. I don't know what that would be.
I'd be down for a handheld.
Oh, to be honest, yeah. Maybe the play-by-play guy go handheld?
Yeah, right.
Well, that's pretty sick, dude. That's pretty sick. I don't know.
Shut up, James.
My only worry is that it would probably catch a lot of noise, but like...
Yeah, you're right.
I kind of want to do it, though. Especially because like, if I have like, lean all the way down here, you know? Like, but then what if I drop it? Like... is there any... Oh, yeah. I flipped this. That's how yours is off before, and that's how.
Okay. There you go. It's like how are we gonna have a hot mic the entire time?
I would actually lose my life because I. I just drop F bombs. I don't say anything racist. That's where I differentiate between a lot of these guys. Did you hear that like guy who's like a former youth pastor and he blamed it on his blood sugar spiking? I mean, oh my god, dude. You're a terrible person, just admit it, dude. Yeah. It's fine, like. What Wi-Fi? Is it just the guest? There's one right next to mine, but I don't know if it'll fit. It might.
I didn't see the horizontal.
How long did it take yours to connect? You should just do the game with English accents.
I know.
At least it fits
one.
No, me too.
And
Westminster's in some good form this season so far, Will. Gonna hope to see if he
Carolina
can continue
blue
today.
And white. Good.
Carolina blue and white. It's like that March Madness tournament coming up over there in the States. I watch too much Serie A on ESPN Plus, dude.
ESPN Plus.
So nice. Oh my god. Because now they have their Serie A and Bundesliga. But the only thing, I don't get any Champions League or Europa. Yeah, so I'm not getting all access just for the Champions League. No way. Really? Is there anything else good on it, though? Or didn't it turn into Paramount Plus? Or is that, like, is it different? I don't who knows? You're right. Who knows at this point?
There's nothing else.
How much is it? $9.99?
Yeah. I split it with
my friends. I literally, would only get it. What are they in now? They're in like the semi or the quarters, right?
The round of 16.
Oh, they're going into 16?
No, they just finished.
So they're going into quarters. Okay.
Yeah.
In Milan, they're in the Europa right now. They have their second round. I think it's 16. I think they, it's their second round of 16 with United. So Thursday. They split the first one 1-1.
When I first started content stuff in the woods, speaking in American accent, comments in American accent, to have like English pronunciations.
Right.
Like some white nags, like I don't know how to describe it, like
speech patterns.
Yeah.
Kinda, right? Yeah. Yeah. No, I know what you're saying. I know what you're
saying. Like, oh, here comes Darren Henderson.
Like, Darren.
I never call anyone Darren.
Darren Henderson.
Like, it's kind of like the point.
But that's like a perfect one, though. Like,
yeah.
Darren Henderson. Oh my god, still connected?
This is still going. This is still bumping.
I hope nobody's watching yet. I mean.
Well, yeah, no, but what happens at halftime?
Right, we just supposed to see her in silence?
Oh, because here's a.
That's why. You were setting me up, Will. You were trying to get me canceled. Not today.
It's still bumping.
Not ever.
It's still bumping.
Did it take you this long, or did you just?
Hey, Kaz, again.
We'll see if it works. It's...
Do you guys stop the audio by chance? So we were able to turn off the mics here, but it's still bumping from some audio.
This is.
Can I just turn that down?
What? Yeah, this is. Feed.
I'm saying when like it's halftime, take a break.
Oh yeah. Yeah, no volume.
Gotcha.
Got it.
Alright, so there's no
problem. Sorry.
Just getting a
power strip.
Bears made very aggressive pursuit for Russell Wilson, but we're told Seahawks are not trading their star QB. Well, then make some moves to make him happy then, A-hole. Well, come on, you can't just hog him and ruin his waste the rest of his career. That's not fair.
I'll get the rest names. For a second. Let's see if I can maybe come talk to that Chris
too. Wait, I'm not AT&T, I'm T-Mobile, that's why.
One. Hello and welcome to Blue Jay Stadium in Fulton, Missouri, where today the Blue Jays of Westminster will host the Tigers of Iowa Wesleyan in their 2021 home opener. Connor McCann alongside Will Nolte giving you the first of a doubleheader today between the Blue Jays and Tigers. The Westminster women lost their first game of the season to Fontbonne by a score of 2-0, but today the team is at home and looking to get their first win of the year.
Yeah, they play a tough Iowa Wesleyan squad right now. The Tigers come in 2-1 on the season, having won both their wins a very large margin the first game of the season against Blackburn College, 9-0, and then most recently on Saturday at Eureka College, 5-1. So this is a very tough Tiger squad here.
From left to right go the Tigers of Iowa Wesleyan starting lineup for them. Kylie Mulhern-Guerre, the goalkeeper. Isela Avalos, Ashlyn Bogue, Ingrid Lima, Jacqueline Campos, Giovanna Pedrasani, Hannah Brower, Caitlin Denny, Melissa Cassana, and Yvette Rodriguez. And for your Westminster Blue Jays, the freshman goalkeeper, Megan Davidson, Abby Montana, Kelsey Gordon, Elena Alsbury, Natalie Schulte, Jenna Frisello, Maddie Watson, Lauren Halomachek, Karina Esquivo, Ellen Witt, and Rachel Nolte.
It seems both teams are lining up in a relative 4-2-3-1. Iowa Wesleyan might be an attacking 4-3-3 right now, but it's a pretty similar formational matchup between these two teams right now.
Both teams just feeling each other out early on in the game. As the goalkeeper, Mulhern-Guerre, takes a shot as she comes up, but she has to get back quickly, and she's lucky that that ball sails wide as she came up pretty far, about 10 yards, maybe 20, to come up and try to clear that one, but it goes right to a Westminster player, and she hits it just wide. Early, early break for the Iowa Wesleyan Tigers. Gordon in that first game against Fontbonne led the Blue Jays with 4 shots, 2 of them on goal. As the ball still in play after some contact, no foul given to the Blue Jays as the Tigers clear. It's back now. Frisella with the ball, passing it ahead. Now Nolte, but she turns it over and now move the Tigers. Tigers have not had the best of luck clearing the ball so far. That have not surrendered anything yet, but Mulhern-Guerre's got to be careful again as she had some pressure there, getting rid of the ball. Is now on the far side of the field. The Tigers will try to keep possession and keep it away from the very eager Blue Jays so far in this one. Halomachek, nice pass as she finds Nolte up the field, but she is unable to get it past the goalkeeper. Mulhern-Guerre makes her first save of the evening, but it's been pressure and constant pressure from the Blue Jays so far early on in this one.
Already just about only 3 minutes into this game or so, you already see the stylistic differences between Iowa Wesleyan and Westminster. I already mentioned that Westminster is trying to go with a little bit of press on Iowa Wesleyan, but whenever the Blue Jays seem to get the ball, they seem to be trying to dump Nolte in behind the defense, whereas Iowa Wesleyan is doing a pretty good job of building from the back. They seem to get the ball really into the Blue Jays' territory and start moving the ball well there to beat the press.
Back four for Iowa Wesleyan has been very busy so far in this one, as once again the Blue Jays are on the move. That was Schulte, as she'll keep possession for her team. Challenged there by Ashlyn Bogue. Throw in for the Blue Jays as it's headed away by Rodriguez, and Westminster will run it back. Into Witt and out of bounds once again, and once again a throw in from the same spot. This time the ball is in the middle of the field now as Lawton Passes it ahead. Cleared away by Denny. Westminster still with possession, though. They've had the large chunk of it so far early on in this one.
Tough foul right there against Iowa Wesleyan. They almost had the Blue Jays trapped right there. And not many options to look for any of the Blue Jays, but it's just tough foul from behind. They got to just keep their head and not commit to a tough foul because they easily let the Blue Jays give the ball over in that scenario if they don't really go in too hard like that.
Lawton back to Montana, who gives it ahead to Witt. Witt running up the field. Covered heavily by Kasana. Now Schulte back to Witt. Tried to do a little give and go to Schulte, but the kick will go out of bounds. Another goal kick for Iowa Wesleyan. Megan Davidson, the Westminster keeper, has been standing about 30 yards in front of her own net for the last 5 minutes or so. She hasn't had any pressure so far. Now she might have to retreat as Iowa Wesleyan gets the ball back. And ahead, it is Pedrasani. But Westminster has done good to prevent any attack whatsoever from the Tigers so far in this one. Now here comes Denny. Ahead to Avalos, but the ball will go out of bounds, just a little out of a reach. The Blue Jays back with the ball.
And that there could have been absolutely the best attack opportunity for the Tigers so far early in this game. It was a great hesitation by Denny there to hold on to the ball as long as possible to get her teammate open, but I believe it was a poor touch from her teammate Avalos to kind of squander their own attack. They had the ball back here on a throw-in, but definitely couldn't have had a really good opportunity.
Kasana throws it in, but throws it away. The Blue Jays on top of it. Here comes Schulte back to Lawton. Dishes it ahead, and it is Schulte making a run, but cannot catch up to it in time as Mulhern Guerre comes out and makes the stop. Tries to clear it, but it's not out of the woods just yet. Here comes Witt. She's got some space to move going into that left corner towards the net, but off the side of it. And that'll be another goal kick for Mulhern Guerre. She's been busy so far in this one, Will.
She has, and Iowa Wesleyan is doing an all right job of keeping their defensive line much further back because it's clear Westminster is trying to use the pace of Schulte on the right and Nolte at top alongside Witt on the far left. They're really trying to use the pace of those three main attacking trio to get behind, but Iowa Wesleyan is going to do a good job of sitting back and really not letting them get in behind.
After the clearance, the Blue Jays with the ball once again. Halimacek. Nice tackle there by Iowa Wesleyan to get the ball out, and now it is Avalos running, but good defense there from Montana to clear the ball. As now it is Witt trying to keep it from going out of bounds, but unable to do so. Iowa Wesleyan remains with possession on the throw. But squander it once again. That's been the theme so far. A lot of these throw-ins have either gone right back out of bounds or have been turned over to the other team.
They really have, and it's something simple when you're a fairly experienced soccer player, as many of these young women are, that really has to be sort of hashed out in practice. A lot of coaches don't like to kind of go over it because they feel like the skill level is a little practice, but it's still something that's practiced at any sort of professional level. It's really something that you cannot give possession of.
Just over 9 minutes into this one, still no score, but the Westminster Blue Jays have been in the zone quite often trying to get this ball into the net, but not on that attempt. A lot of good work on the offensive end for them, but just unable to get that one clean shot. Surprising to see that this is, it's surprising to see this is the first corner so far, considering how often they've had the ball. And here it comes into the zone, partially clear, but not enough. The header is, looks like that was off the head of Schulte, but unable to get to the back of the net. Now here is Gordon on the opposite side, gets it back in to Nolte, but she just barely squeaks it by the opposite post. And it'll go out of bounds for another goal kick. Nolte just barely wide on that shot. And that was the first real chance of the game for the Blue Jays.
Another great opportunity there. It comes off a set piece where pretty much the entire back line is backed up against the goal or so. It's really tough to beat that low block, especially when most of the skill that Westminster relies on is on the pace of Schulte. But it's still a very good opportunity by the Blue Jays on that last possession there.
Blue Jays still with possession. It's Allsbury trying to get it ahead to Nolte, but the pass was blocked partially. Still with the possession is Westminster. Esquivel ahead to Schulte, who tried to hit it up for Frisella, but nothing there. Now here comes Iowa Wesleyan, but they're able to turn over. This is the first action that Megan Davidson has had all game long as her teammate kicks it back to her for a clearance.
Davidson had all the time in the world right there. She's got to have to look for any sort of Blue Jays moving off the ball right there. She didn't see really any, which is why Iowa Wesleyan has the ball right there. But if you're the Blue Jays, the ball's in your own goalkeeper's box like that. You have to be moving. Get some sort of, give her some sort of option off the ball instead of rather just booting it back to the Tigers.
So now Iowa Wesleyan with the ball on the other side of the field. First time they've had an extended offensive set. As Brower tries to get it ahead. And the ball will go out of bounds for another throw in for the Tigers. Far side of the field, they'll throw it in. And the ball will go out once again. Throwing once again for Iowa Wesleyan. Cutting ahead is Avalos. But two Blue Jays converge on her, force the tackle, and now Davidson with the ball.
And that was a great run made by Avalos on that diagonal right to the corner of the box. One of her teammates has to give her some sort of option to cut it right back to get the ball back into the box. Because if she's double-teamed like that, her only option is to go right back. But had she had an option there, they would have been pretty fairly open for a goal. This is Westminster Core right now.
And Witt with a fast run. She has a teammate. And, unfortunately, Schulte cut, but the pass was just out in front of her. She could not get a boot on it, and it goes out of bounds. That was probably the best chance Westminster's had all night, and that was a sure goal if the pass was just a foot closer to Schulte right there.
It was certainly the best opportunity of the game right now for between either team. They really came off of Iowa Wesleyan's fantastic attacking opportunity on the other side of the net. Westminster was able to hit them on a counterattack, which, using the pace of their top three trio, is what they're wanting to try to do. Iowa Wesleyan's defense cannot be caught that too high, or else that's really going to cause them trouble all game.
Nolte gives it to Witt, but it is cleared partially by Iowa Wesleyan. Now here comes Montana, but she's unable to find anybody else. It'll be another giveaway for the Blue Jays as the Tigers will throw it in just to throw it away once again. A lot of early trouble on throw-ins for both teams so far. As now, Alsbury will throw it in. Blue Jays getting close once again. Tried to find Nolte, but unable to. Header in from Alsbury, but can't find the mark. Just clearing it once again is Denny. For Alsbury, but the ball goes out of bounds. Change of possession once again.
That was a great opportunity right there. Alsbury had the space all down that left-hand flank, coming, making that run from her left-back position, but ball was just a little bit too far ahead of her. Had she gotten that, she really could have been down that left-hand flank, almost wide open for her crossing back inside the box.
And now Beau trying to form up a run, but nobody joining her. She'll have to kick it away.
This is good from Westminster here. Try and pass out of the back. Get Iowa Wesleyan caught out of position as they attempt to get them to press to be able to play a ball like that to get in behind the defense.
And Alsbury with a clear path now. She waits for her teammates to join her. Tried to get it to Witt, but it goes back now to Montana, who kicks it up ahead. Some pressure from Westminster as they converge on the ball, trying to get another shot on goal. But the last touch out of bounds is on Elson Witt, giving the ball to the Tigers.
I saw it like from that last position from Westminster. The great passing in the bat led to that pass in behind, but that precision really needs to have to be there if they want to get a clear opportunity on goal.
In the corner, Westminster trying to get something going, but Schulte can't find anybody in the box, picked up by Mulhern-Guerre. She'll clear that ahead, but directly back to the Blue Jays. Now, Campos with the ball. Back to Rodriguez. And another turnover for the Tigers. In the back, it's Montana. Ahead to Gordon. And now to Alsbury. They've been trying to find Alsbury cutting ahead, and it's worked the last two times. But she's unable to get it back to Witt, and the ball will go out of bounds. Or it looks to be another goal kick. Or no, it'll be a corner instead. Excuse me.
Second one of the game coming from Westminster. Just about, I'd say, 18 minutes here into this game. Still 0-0 between Westminster and Iowa Wesleyan. But another good opportunity, as we saw. They had a really dangerous opportunity last time they had a corner.
Corner on the way. It's a good one. It's played on the out of the air by Mulhern-Guerre. Back now to Halimacek, who took the corner. Another set piece, but a lot of black jerseys in the box. Not a lot of room for the Blue Jays to operate. Here's Lawton.
And on that corner right there, Kylie Mulhern-Guerre came out to really claim that ball, but didn't come out with enough power and, presence to punch it away from any danger. She got contact on the ball, but it still parried off her hand and into the rest of the box for an opportunity. If she's going to come out like that, she's either going to have to catch it or punch it where no other player on the field is. It's Westminster going to make their first substitution here.
It'll be Witt coming out of the game. And coming in is Annalise Beck out of St. Louis from Notre Dame High School. Replacing Schulte was very, very busy in the first 19 minutes of this one. As the pressure continues for the Blue Jays, they've had the ball on the Iowa Wesleyan side of the field for almost all 20 minutes, but unable to produce the first goal of the match so far, as we're still knotted at zero. Nolte Too heavy a touch, gives it away, and now Iowa Wesleyan's got some numbers. A counterattack. This is the best shot they've had so far. Up ahead is Avalos. But good defensive presence from Karina Esquivel to prevent Avalos from getting any further. It'll be a throw-in for Iowa Wesleyan as they've shown some life here. A nice counterattack on that last try, but unable to get anything further than about 60 yards up the field.
Almost all set up by interception in the midfield by Jacqueline Campos, and the ball she sent to Avalos down the left-hand side of the field. It was a great presence in the midfield. She has a ball right here trying to force anything for Iowa Wesleyan.
As now the Blue Jays try to take the ball the other way. It's Gordon trying to find Nolte, but Nolte went one way, the pass went the other. Blue Jays able to retain possession. As now Lawton with the ball in the middle of the field. She's met by the defender. Goes to the ground, but no foul called. Here's Gordon. Now Halimacek. Ahead, great ball to Frisella. To the center, just out of the reach of Nolte. That was another great chance, but the ball's still in play.
That ball was right to Nolte, but she timed her run just a little too early, so she got there right underneath the ball. She timed that maybe half or a second later. She could have gotten to that ball with an easy shot on goal.
It's a long shot attempt from Maddie Lawton, easily saved by Mohern Guerre, and she'll try to clear it once again. Another good run for the Westminster Blue Jays, but still unable to come up with that first goal of the match. As Iowa Wesleyan having a tough time just getting it out of their own half. Here's Nolte, another chance. Another cross into the center. Nobody there, nobody home. Back now to Halimacek. As now, once again, it is Lawton. And I believe it's going to be a corner.
It looked.
Two long shots from Lawton, both of them on the mark, but saved by Mohern Guerre. The cross on the corner is dealt with by the Iowa Wesleyan defense. And now another cross into the box, but nobody there for the Blue Jays. A lot of black jerseys doing a good job defending the box. One thing about Iowa Wesleyan in this game, they may not have had too much possession, but when push comes to shove and when the Blue Jays are getting close to scoring that goal, getting in that box, they're playing some great defense, preventing them from doing so.
Well, as we're about 23 minutes in, still 0-0 here, so Iowa Wesleyan is still playing defense. Just going to take one counterattack opportunity, though, for the Blue Jays or for Iowa Wesleyan to really break the tie here in Fulton. But you have to think, with the amount of opportunities Westminster has had so far today, one of these chances is going to eventually fall from them. That's what they're kind of banking on here in this half.
As Iowa Wesleyan trying to get another run going. Isella Avalos has been the catalyst for what little offense Iowa Wesleyan has been able to produce. She's pretty much been in the center of everything. As now Iowa Wesleyan, with some pressure of their own, as Westminster tries to get the ball out of their half. They are able to do so before it is kicked out of bounds by Melissa Cassano.
I like what I saw there from Iowa Wesleyan, because they had the pressure on the Westminster Blue Jays defense, but didn't sacrifice anything on their own defensive end to allow any sort of counterattack or long ball in behind their defense. There were no options for the Blue Jays as they tried to really lead a counterattack. It was good pressure from the Iowa Wesleyan attackers on the Westminster back line to really give the ball up in that sort of scenario.
throw in for the Blue Jays is Allsbury. As she throws it to nobody in particular, it'll roll out of bounds, and it'll be another goal kick for Kylie Mohern-Guier, the freshman goalkeeper from Chandler, Arizona, who's had a busy, busy start to this one so far. Has not folded yet, but has had to deal with a lot of pressure from the Westminster Blue Jays. As once again, they force a turnover. On the offense now, here comes Beck. This first substitution of the game, ahead to Nolte. Beck once again with the shot, but it bounces off the back of her teammate. And now a counter opportunity for Iowa Wesleyan should they take it. Pass picked off by Jennifer Sella. And now the Blue Jays in business once again. Here's Schulte. And she has a chance. Gets it off to Gordon. Gordon with the cross, but it is just too high. Another frantic moment there on the defensive side for Iowa Wesleyan. And Kylie Mohern-Guier coming out. And for a second, Natalie Schulte had an open net to deal with, but some good defense from Iowa Wesleyan forced the pass. And we are still scoreless just under 26 minutes into this one.
Get that ball in the back of the net. That's really, it's a lot to teach of a striker in that scenario. It's really hard to get it out of a game, but if you can keep your composure like that, to not really force anything, try and get anything into the net, you can certainly get a goal in that scenario 9 times out of 10.
And Esquivel had her hands full with Avalos right there. Avalos able to earn the throw in for the Tigers as they look to go on the attack themselves, try to get something going. Wanted a handball there, but not one called. And it will be the Blue Jays ball going the other way. Not a lot of work had been done by the back line so far for the Blue Jays. They've been on the offense quite often early on in this one as they look to be once again as that pass just ahead of Rachel Nolte, and it will get to the keeper as Mohern-Guier will look to clear it once again. But now it looks as if Ashlyn Bogue is down on the ground.
Stop here just about 28 minutes into this game. Gives at least Iowa Wesleyan, who looks to get a water break while Westminster are standing around midfield trying to talk amongst themselves about what the game plan is going forward. They have plenty of opportunities in front of them to take a hold of this lead and take a hold of this game. It's still 0-0. But really, what can they do next?
As Bo will sit down on the bench. It's 17 and a half minutes left in this first half. And like you said, Will, look, it seems as if both teams just need to figure out what they have to do, because the game plan for the Blue Jays has worked so far. It's worked very, very well. They've had all the chances in this game so far, and they've done everything right. But for Iowa Wesleyan, they've played some great defense, and they've formed a few counterattacks that you look at them and you say, well, the right one of those might just be enough to win them this game.
Certainly the right one of those, and they have to stay really defensively composed, defensively still in their formation. If they get caught once, Westminster looked to be sure to burn them as it was good positioning right there to get an interception. That has to continue throughout the entire game when you're sort of possessionally outmatched like they are right now.
And coming into this game for Bogue for Iowa Wesleyan is Sherelle Kent. Kent getting her first touch of the game on the near side just a moment ago. As now Iowa Wesleyan once again, and there is Azella Avalo. She has been all over the field tonight, doing her best to try to get something started for this Iowa Wesleyan attacking front. As here comes Nolte. Nice pass back to Lenk, who is also subbed in. Started in the first game, but a substitution here. Schulte with a chance, but the ball is cleared, and it'll be, I think, yet another corner for... No, it's going to be a goal kick, is the decision.
One thing Westminster has done very well, like we saw in that last possession right there, is timing their runs. They are trying to really get in behind this Iowa Wesleyan defense. And even though Iowa Wesleyan is sitting a little further back, they've not been called for offside this entire game, I don't believe, Westminster. So to be able to time the runs like that, like the one Kelsey Gordon had about 30 seconds ago, is really a testament to their awareness on the field.
It's been a very well-played game so far from both teams. Just one foul called so far, and no cards, no offside. As Megan Davidson, whose name we've rarely had to call, as opposed to her opposing keeper, she'll clear that one away. Ahead to Nolte, but once again, the defense of Iowa Wesleyan forcing a takeaway, and they'll try to move the other direction. Avalos taken away. As Campos now ahead, but yet another turnover by the Tigers. Lenk back to Esquivel. Ahead to Alsbury, who had a nice tackle on Cassano, was able to get the ball ahead. And now here comes Schulte. This should be a good chance for the Blue Jays. And it's off the side of the net, but it looked to be saved by Mohanguier. It'll be another corner for the Blue Jays. Their fourth. Taking it will be Maddie Lenk. Ball is still in the zone. Off the back of a defender was the attempt from Schulte. And this time, it'll go out of bounds off of the foot of a Blue Jay. Another goal kick. Another chance for the Blue Jays, but the Iowa Wesleyan defense setting up ground and not giving up any in the middle. The box has been controlled by the Tigers so far. A few good crossing chances for the Blue Jays, but all of them just a foot or two out of reach. As this is a clearance gone wrong for Wesleyan, they've got the ball back deep in their own end, and they force a turnover, but able to get it back. They just want to get the ball out right now, but the Blue Jays, look at this pressure. Now finally some space for Jacqueline Campos, but she can't get it ahead to Kent, and it'll be a throw-in for Westminster. What a sequence right there.
How about Westland seem to be doing really well right there, beating the press from Westminster to not give the ball really deep in their own territory. They almost could have had it. The pass was just a little bit behind her teammate right there to going out of bounds early in the area. Honestly, she probably could have held on to that a little longer, Campos could have, to find an even better option further on up the field, maybe in behind the Westminster defense. They were caught off a little high.
This is some good news for Iowa Wesleyan. Bogue has checked back in. She seems to be okay. Kent back to the bench. So glad to see that Bogue is not seriously injured. She's able to play, and she's back on the field for the final 12 minutes or so of this first half. still scoreless here in Fulton, but this is a nice ball ahead to Nolte. She's going to have a shot. But that was a good rebound by Padrasani to get the ball away. Check that. That was Caitlin Denny, excuse me. But Westminster still with the ball. Gordon ahead to Schulte. Tried to cross it, but it is off of Lima for the fifth corner of the game.
Start taking advantage of it because they can rack up their shots and corners and possession numbers all they want, but if the score is still zero, it's really all for nothing. So it's got to come in the final 11 minutes of this first half really take control of this game for Westminster.
Back takes the corner. It's partially saved by Mohern Guerre, but then cleared by her teammates. Another one of those, Will, where Mohern Guerre decides to come out but doesn't really make the split-second decision. Are you going to catch it? Are you going to hit it away? Because it stayed in the box, and all of a sudden you got another wide-open net.
I think there is rarely an opportunity like that, or rarely a scenario, I should say, where there's a corner like that where the box is so congested where you opt to catch it. You have to really punch it every single time away from any sort of defender, because if you try and catch it, there's too many bodies there that you could just end up missing it or bobbling it and give it up to the wrong person. You have to punch it out as far as you can in any direction.
Now Westminster once again taking the ball away and forcing it back into the hands of Kylie Mohern Guerre. So we get set to enter the 36th minute. Still 0-0 here at Blue Jay Stadium. Schulte trying to track down the ball, but Mohern Guerre comes out once again, about 15 yards in front of her goal. Did not play any games with that one, made sure she got a hand on it, as now here comes Iowa Wesleyan, ahead to Avalos, but she can't get it to Squibb, as it'll be another turnover, but now once again, Wesleyan with the ball. Brower ahead. Bogue trying to track it down, but coming out is Davidson to corral it.
And you were right, she had Bogue there. Bogue was making an excellent run almost in behind the Westminster defense on track. Brower went for the shot right there, which honestly, it took a rather lucky deflection as Bogue was almost there to run onto. But I showed you, she played a pass just right onto Bogue. She got her head up and saw her teammate making that run. That could have been a very dangerous opportunity for Iowa Wesleyan to test Megan Davidson, the keeper for Westminster, for the first time this game.
Instead, Davidson is still yet to face a shot. Just under 9 minutes left here in the first half. Still scoreless as the Westminster Blue Jays have, I'd say, had a pretty good handle on this one so far, but now it is Iowa Wesleyan who is attacking and threatening.
And Iowa Wesleyan just made a substitution, taking off their striker, Shalina Squibb, bringing on Sherelle Kent at striker, almost a straight swap at striker. They've been almost looking to get it to Squibb at that number nine position almost the entire game. Any sort of time they get an attack, have Squibb just back down the Westminster defense. Here's Kent with the ball right now, trying to make something of it, but it'd be an interesting tactical decision to see what can happen with Kent on the field right now offensively for Iowa Wesleyan instead of Squibb.
And Squibb had not had too much action so far in this one. Like you said, well, they have been trying to get her the ball, but it just had not been too successful up to this point. Maybe that's why the change was made, as now a great ball up the field, and Westminster has numbers. They're going to have a chance unless Melissa Cassana can track down this ball first. She can't. Ahead, it is Gordon. Gordon's going to put it in. She is going to score, and finally in this one, it is Westminster up on top.
Fantastic run by there, but from Kelsey Gordon. Even better ball played in behind for Gordon to run onto. She was the one of a couple who had the opportunity to get that ball. She comes all the way from the left wing position to run and meet that ball first. A little bit of collision right there, but it kept her strength and kept her foot locked to keep control of the ball and really force Mulhern-Guerre to come out of her box to get a wide open shot on goal that far out. Fantastic goal from Westminster, 1-0 here in just about the 38th minute of play. Still 7 minutes to go, but this game plan going into the first half, or going into halftime, I should say, and into the second half, really changes the entire game now that the Blue Jays are up 1-0. Another great tackle from Gordon right there.
And when you saw that run developing, you just knew it had to be something special. The initial ball was so well played. There were about four Blue Jays running in, and only Melissa Cassano was back. And once she got beat, it was almost hopeless for Kylie Mulhern-Guerre. Just a terrific job by Westminster. They've deserved to be leading in this game so far, one might think, the way they've been playing. And now they are 1-0. As Wesleyan looks to regroup, it's Campos back to Rodriguez.
It's interesting to see Westminster still going with that press, still going with that high defensive line. That's a great ball there as a, I think that's Nolte being onside.
Nolte has a chance, but a great save made by Mulhern-Guerre, and then Nolte botched the second attempt. Defenders thought she was offside, but no flag ever went up, so she, it would have been
definitely
an attempt.
She was on it, really an overlapping run behind the attacking midfielder. Didn't catch the exact number and name there, but still timing her run perfectly as it was more of an overlap banana-shaped run in behind the defense.
As now another attempt, here's Natalie Schulte. All she's got to do is find an angle, but she is unable to do so. Mulhern-Guerre's struggled so far tonight and figuring out when she wants to come out because she's left her net open far too many times.
Well, if you made that decision to come out like that, it can be a good decision, especially if your defense is really beat like they were on the last attempt just a few seconds ago, but it just did not end up in her favor that time. It still was a tough angle for Schulte to get a good shot off on goal.
Now Westminster looking to add another one before halftime. We approach the 40th minute. Here's Lawton. Lawton back to Frisella. And up ahead now to Nolte. Nolte crosses it. In the middle here is Gordon, the goal scorer in this one. Back to Alsbury. Tries to get it ahead, but it is cleared by Rodriguez. Back to Frisella. And here comes Schulte. Schulte has a run, but another nice save by Kylie Mulhern-Guerre to prevent. That was looked like to be another easy goal for Schulte.
Fantastic turn by Schulte right there to set up an almost certain wide open goal. Mulhern-Guerre cut the distance in between her and Schulte in a very, very matter of almost second or two to really close the gap and make the angle a little tougher. And it was a fantastic goalkeeping effort and save right there from Mulhern-Guerre to prevent the second goal.
And right there is Abby Montana, got her head on it, but it goes just wide to the left. Very nice attempt right there. Probably the best looking corner we've seen from Westminster so far. Almost resulting in a goal. Montana able to climb amongst the trees and get to the sky, but unable to put her head on it and put it in the goal.
Montana's only 5'5", and still goes above nearly everybody in the box right there to get that open head off. And still was, just came off the top of her head a little bit and to sail over the net, but still fantastic athleticism being shown to get that ball over everybody else in the box.
And once again, there's Isela Avalos trying to make something happen, forces the throw in for Iowa Wesleyan, and she has been one of the catalysts in this game, really one of the catalysts all season long, tied for the team lead with 3 goals on the year with Jacqueline Campos.
Awkwardly in an awkward position on their back line, was able to press to to force Westminster in an own throw-in really deep almost at their own corner flag back there. Maybe try and get something in the final 3 minutes or so of this first half. So now that's about the 42nd minute of play. They got right back, actually.
Here comes Wesleyan. And Campos coming in, but good defense there by Frisella.
Campos did a fantastic job right there of getting almost around the entire Westminster defense. And that's a great ball being played to keep her onside.
And Schulte beats everybody. One person to beat. It's the keeper. She does. And it is a 2-0 lead for the Westminster Blue Jays.
Schulte picked that up right in the midfield and found Schulte with no defenders around here. Rounds her 60 yards out right at midfield with her back to goal. Schulte turned on that and beat every single defender on her own 2 feet with the speed she used. She went 60 yards with that ball and scored a goal. That's a fantastic goal right there. Schulte
has been very busy all game long. She has been running up and down the field, making all kinds of plays, picking up passes in the defensive end and turning them into plays on offense, and she is rewarded with the goal right there as Nolte is able to pick up the assist, and a couple of subs coming in for Westminster as well. Schulte is going to come out. Chance Estrada is going to come into the game, as well as Abby Kloss.
Nolte gets her first assist ever at the collegiate level. She is only just a freshman from Wentzville, and her first assist, I guess, in a Blue Jays uniform as well.
Entering now the 43rd minute. It's been all Blue Jays in the first half. Iowa Wesleyan looking for just something here, as here comes Sherelle Kent, and this is a good attacking opportunity for the Tigers, the best one they've had so far, but nobody in to receive the cross from Ashlyn Bogue, and it is collected by Davidson as the chance is thwarted relatively easily for the Blue Jays.
And it's not the first time we've seen an Iowa Wesleyan player pick up the ball like that, eaten very, very deep into Blue Jay territory. And all the other Tigers seem to be just standing around watching instead of really getting open and giving her an opportunity to get rid of it in from the corner flag.
Nolte with the ball. She's in control. Ahead to Beck. She's looking for the cross. Unable to get it, but it will be a corner kick. The seventh now already in the first half for the Blue Jays as we approach the final minute of the first half before stoppage time.
Game out of reach here just in the first half if they could get a goal right here.
Another good corner kick, but nobody home to receive it, as that time it was Beck trying to get the header in, but it's saved by Aguirre. Just 33 seconds left before we see if we get any stoppage time. Not a whole lot of empty time. There was the Bogue injury and the two goals, but not a lot of fouls. As here's a nice ball up ahead, as it's Bogue this time. But once
she only had 15 seconds on that clock and just trying to get any sort of shot off. Maybe had Kent streaking into that box right there, but I think the time may have just gotten to her head right there to force a shot off. And I think it might be just be the last kick of the first half.
And what we've seen a lot of in that first half was whenever Iowa Wesleyan is able to finally get that attack, there's nobody there to receive the cross, and there's nobody, you know, to help the ball carrier or the handler, you know. It's very difficult when you don't have any assist from your teammates trying to get to the goal. As now appears we have another injury right before the half.
Yeah, I didn't see exactly which Tigers player hit the deck, but just ending the first half, it's almost may have waited to halftime to get any sort of help being helped offered off the field by her teammates. I believe I caught, didn't exactly catch a glimpse of who exactly it was, but still going into halftime right now, 2-0 for Westminster over Iowa Wesleyan. We'll probably take about a 15-minute break here and be back for the start of the second half of action here at Blue Jays Field.
1. And welcome back to Blue Jay Stadium in Fulton, Missouri. Second half of action between the Iowa Wesleyan Tigers and the Westminster Blue Jays about to kick off. Blue Jays with a very, very exciting first half. Up 2-0 on Iowa Wesleyan. And Will, what did you see from the Westminster Blue Jays in that first half? How did they get off to this 2-0 lead?
I saw a lot of them sticking to their own game plan. They had that top three of their offense, which was Nolte, Schulte, and then Gordon out left right now, but Witt started out on the left in the first half. And they really tried to use the pace of those three to get in behind this Iowa Wesleyan defense, and it paid off in their two goals they scored. Iowa Wesleyan played a really good job of playing a really deep back line, a low block, that's what they would call, but balls like that in behind them, and with the speed of Schulte like that, Westminster was able to take a 2-0 lead.
And Schulte used that speed to score her first goal of the day, the second of the game for the team. It was Kelsey Gordon getting the first, and as we saw right there, once again, Schulte using some blazing speed to earn another corner for Westminster.
Already a corner just about 40 seconds into the game.
Seven in the first half for the Blue Jays. This is the first of the second. Taking it is Halimacek, but it is headed in and saved by the goalkeeper, Kylie Mohorn-Guerre, whose name we called quite a bit in that first half. She was very busy. More of the same so far in this half for Westminster. In that first half, they were pressuring the Iowa Wesleyan back four. A lot of possession time in that half of the field. And right now doing more of the same, keeping possession, the ball away from the Tigers as it's ahead to Schulte, but just out of her reach and out of play to be thrown in by Giovanna Pedrasani. Brower turns it over. Here's Maddie Lenk, another substitute in that first half. Ahead to Schulte using her speed once again, and she'll have it. Tries to cross it in to Nolte, but unable to get it there as the header by Halimacek goes into the hands of Mohorn-Guerre.
That was good timing by Halimacek there to recognize the cross was not initially going to her and back off her run a little bit to time it right, get the rebound, and time her run more to the rebound as opposed to the cross. And it ended up with her getting ahead on it. Didn't exactly end up in her favor as it was, still ended up going to the goalkeeper, but still a great timing of the run right there that could absolutely work out in favor in the future.
Kelsey Gordon wreaking some havoc in the back as she forces another turnover, and now it is Lawton. Lawton kicks it back, and now it is Frisella coming up from the back line, ahead to Nolte, who will look to cross it over, but it is on top of the goal, over everybody's head, and good for a goal kick.
Original positions from Nolte and Schulte with players making runs into the box for an opportunity for a cross, and Westminster could certainly get a couple more in this game on top of their two already.
Once again, it is Mohorn-Guerre clearing the ball, but can't get it past midfield as the attacking core of this Westminster Blue Jays team has been on fire today. They have not let up. And for the 49 minutes we've played so far, they have been electric. Esquivel passes it ahead. She's had a good game defending. Almost any small chance Wesleyan's able to create is almost immediately squashed by either her or Frisella. There, Maddie Lawden comes in to force the turnover. And it's kicked ahead to Nolte, who's been very, very busy. Kicked out of bounds by Denny. Blue Jays will keep ball and possession. Thrown ahead to Nolte, but off of her foot, just a little bit too heavy on the touch. Goes out of bounds, and it'll be the Tigers now. As Nolte able to force Denny to hit it off her chest and out of bounds. It'll be another throw in. Frisella to Nolte, but cleared away by Rodriguez. Now Lawden, ahead to Schulte, and just...
Great idea right there, trying to get a touch into Gordon in behind, just a little too heavy on that pass right there, ends up out of bounds, but Gordon certainly could have been, was making that run, could have certainly got to the pass, had it been just a little lighter on the touch.
Cleared once again by Mohan Gier, and taken away once again by the Blue Jays. But this time, a rare foul called by referee T.J. Higgins. Just the second time his whistles had to blow all night long.
I believe you're right. It's going to be a really good set-piece opportunity now for Westminster. As you can see, they're putting about eight players in and around the box or within about 10 yards of that 18-yard box. So they're really trying, certainly, to get that third goal of this game.
Esquivel with the free kick, but nothing doing for the Jefferson City native. Unable to get it over the head of the Wesleyan defenders, and now they'll try to form an attack of their own as Squibb, who is back in the game, tries to battle Esquivel, and Esquivel comes out on top this time and gets it away. This now Schulte has some room to work with. Nolte right behind her. Schulte going for her second goal of the game, but a nice save as Mulhern Guillard comes out and gets a boot on it to force another corner kick, the ninth of the game, but more importantly, to keep it a 2-0 lead for the Blue Jays.
Very reminiscent of Schulte's first goal and Westminster's second goal of the game with a very nice turn on that back line and then using the speed to beat everyone else trying to catch up with her. Difficult angle right there, and Mohan Gier did a very good job of closing that gap to make the angle even more challenging for Schulte, but still ends up in a corner.
Halimacek takes it. It's in the area, and it is kicked away by Frisella over the head of everybody.
You can tell that Frisella right there as the almost, what you call, garbage or cleanup player. When that ball comes out of the box like that, she's all alone running up to that. You can tell how excited she was to really get that shot on goal and was lining up for it almost as soon as that ball was headed away. But just a little too much power of it, and maybe just got too much, a little under it to fire it over the goal.
Clearance from Mohan Gier goes out of bounds, and once again it is Westminster with the throw. As it's back to Rodriguez as she clears it off the head of Natalie Schulte. Westminster still with position and possession. As it is ahead now to Schulte, tries to find Gordon. But coming out is Mohan Gier.
That's a couple times we've seen that from Schulte this game. She's done a very good job of getting in behind the defense. But when those balls come back to her, when she's making a run away from goal at the center striker right there, she's knowing exactly where every other player is in the field. And she's trying to touch it to Gordon, who's making that run in behind her, but hasn't worked out yet. But you can tell that it's definitely something that they're really trying to work on.
Is now trying to get something going on offense are the Tigers. Squibb behind her to Bogue. Up ahead to Campos. And back now. Handled by Frisella. And now Nolte ahead to Schulte. And Schulte's got the speed. Can't she catch up to Rodriguez? Not in time. And she is going to clear it away. Schulte has just got some blazing speed. And as we are now almost 55 minutes into this game, she has not let up a bit. Campos ahead to Squibb. Try to get it back to Campos. And it's Esquivel back to Davidson for the clearance. It was pretty. It took a long time in that second half, in that first half as well. Excuse me, about the same time, around 10 minutes. She was spending most of that first half hanging out around 30 yards in front of her own net. As Campos back to Brower, turns it over once again. Here's Frisella, and Brower trying to make something happen, but Westminster keeps the ball. Nolte wanted it, but just a little behind her. She had a run towards the net. Still possession, though, was Westminster. Maddie Lenk. Back to Abby Montana. Another defender who has kept a clean sheet so far for Fulton. Excuse me, for Westminster tonight in Fulton. As the 2-0 lead remains, throw in for Wesleyan. Here come the Tigers. Campos with the ball. Tie for the league lead in goals as she tries to get it to the other team leader, Isela Avalos, but unable to. As now here's another chance. Kelsey Gordon ahead. Tried to cross to Nolte, but didn't get enough on it. Now it's Aylesbury ahead. And cleared away by Rodriguez, now Campos. Ahead to Pedrasani, back to Campos. Now to Brower. Pedrasani to Avalos on the wing. Another heavy touch from Avalos. She's frustrated with herself. She's had a few of those today. She's had some good runs, but just a few heavy touches that have either caused the ball to go out of bounds or directly to another player. But Wesleyan remains with the ball. Now the Blue Jays with the turn of their own, but it's taken away by Bogue. But unfortunately for her, she's unable to keep it in play. Throw in for Westminster to Nolte. Back to Lawson. Lawton. Ahead again to Nolte. A little heavy on the touch to Schulte, but she battles with Rodriguez to keep possession. Now it's Lenk. Lenk with a long shot off the gloves of Mohringier, but she's able to hold on to it. Now, it seems that Wesleyan is trying ever so harder to try to get that goal opportunity. They're trying to force things a little bit more often on the offensive side. They were content to play defense in that first half, but now they're trying to push the pace as Avalos ahead to Lima. Back to Avalos. Try to find Squibb, but unable to, and now Westminster takes it the other way. Ahead to Nolte. About a 5-on-6 here, and Nolte wants to do it herself. Beats two defenders, nobody there to get the cross. But here comes Schulte to make it a little bit more difficult.
Yeah, good press right there. You get the ball right back. You got to just clear away out of any sort of danger. There's that many Blue Jays sitting right in front of the back line.
Kasana turned it over directly to a Blue Jay, but able to re-corral it was Yvette Rodriguez. Send it the other way. Here comes Avalos now. Beats Allsbury. But taking it away is Montana. And earning the Blue Jay throw-in. Avalos. They've been content to try to let her do it by herself over there on that far wing, but it has not worked out too well so far in this half.
And she's been trying to use that pace down the right-hand flank, which has worked a couple times. When she's the one making the run in behind the defense or into the space, but trying to make it something of herself, she needs a teammate. She needs some sort of help, really, to get to galvanize, really, this offense.
Lawton comes out for the Blue Jays. In comes Annalise Beck. Beck came in that first half as well. Had some good contributions, winning the ball away from defenders and forcing the issue on offense. Here comes Nolte, speaking of forcing the issue. She's done a ton of that tonight. Esquivel now.
Esquivel is a center back, and having this much space down the right-hand flank is really a testament to the low block that Iowa Wesleyan is playing, and the space that they're letting really the everyone but
Less than 30 minutes now left as the Blue Jays try to hold on to their 2-0 lead. Or maybe add on to it as well, as here is Lauren Halimacek into the hands of Mulhern Guillier. Blue Jays able to keep the ball. It seems that whenever Mulhern Guillier is making the clearance, she just kicks it away and Westminster picks it up. As Beck now with the ball.
Yeah, it seems that Iowa Wesleyan is really realizing that most of the opportunities are for Westminster are coming when that ball is played in behind their defense. So their defense is going to just sit back as far as they can. Right now they're currently in their own 18-yard box, but to not really allow any sort of ball that's going to break their lines or anything. But they'll let Westminster pass along their back line all day if it means that none of those balls are going to be
Maddie Lank checks out, and back into the game is Elson Witt, who started the game for the Blue Jays. Throwing it in is Jenna Frisella, the freshman from St. Louis. As now it is Pedrasani trying to play keep away from the Blue Jays, but Westminster is able to get it back. And now Avalos has some room to run. Ahead, she tries to find Squibb, but just a little bit of a heavy touch. Coming up is Davidson, and she should be able to clear this. She'll pick it up and throw it away to Frisella. Going the other way now is Westminster. Here's Gordon, one of the goal scorers for the Blue Jays today. Ahead to Witt, just checked back in for the first time in the second half. Now Beck. Leaves it for Frisella. To Halimacek. Now to Gordon. Finds Witt. But Witt kicks it into the chest of Mulhern Guillier. Another save for her. She's been very, very busy. Only been beaten twice.
And that positioning seems to be working out for the Iowa Wesleyan back line so far this half. When they're sitting back that far, they're letting Witt kind of dance around with the ball on the far side of the box or so, and recognizing that she's not really have any sort of options to play to any teammates, forcing her to take a tough awkward angle shots and really giving up possession just like that.
Still on the attack are the Blue Jays, but turning it over. Hannah Brower does the same for Wesleyan, but and that was a chance for Rachel Nolte, but coming out once again was Mulhern Guillier, did just enough to prevent her from putting it into the back of the net. Rodriguez. It's been a tough day for the back line of Iowa Wesleyan. They have been tested constantly. And for all the, you know, attempts that Westminster has had, I mean, you'd have to say, even though being down 2-0, it's not the worst offensive effort from Wesley, because I mean, all the chances that Westminster's had, probably could be a lot worse.
I certainly think it's a fairly good defensive effort from Iowa Wesley right now. What really is lacking is their leaking play from the midfield, or from their in the midfield, from their defense to their attack. Like right here, when they win the ball in their defense, they have to start making a play. And this is great right here, but that ball into and in behind the Westminster defense really has to be in a place where only a Tigers player can get it, or a fellow Tiger can get it. It really starts with the runs being made by the Tigers attackers. And it's really that's lacking, that's not going to get the Tigers back into this game. If they can make that change in the final 24 minutes of this game, it can really certainly challenge the Blue Jays and make this a game again. But if this continues for the next 24 minutes, then Westminster's just going to keep passing around and ride this game out.
And that was a rare possession in the offensive zone for Wesleyan, unable to do anything with it. Now here comes Schulte, the pass from Witt. Can't she catch up to it? She's able to keep it in play, but no, she's not. They say it'll be a goal kick. Or a throw-in, excuse me.
Yeah, it was a good job keeping the ball off that line and really just forcing a clearance, only resulting in a throw-in. So good job by Schulte to keep the ball in there.
So Westminster gives possession away on the throw. Denny. Ahead to Pedrosani. Dealt with by Esquivel. And now sent back to Montana. Witt with a lot of space to work with on the far wing. But coming over is Campos. She's been all over the field in this one today. Nothing really to show for it, but she has been working, as that one is just out of reach of Jennifer Frisella. Throw in for Iowa Wesleyan.
A couple substitutions being made as well for Westminster. It looks like Schulte and Helmichek are making their way on the field. Definitely two of the best players that the Blue Jays have had on the field today. You wonder if this kind of resting their legs for upcoming games to come. But I believe incoming for Westminster versus Becca Bonds in the midfield for Helmichek. Chance Estrada at striker. First time we've seen either of these two Blue Jays today.
Becca Bond, one of the two players on this roster not from the state of Missouri. Bond hailing from Midwest City, Oklahoma. As Westminster hanging on to a 2-0 lead. Very comfortable in this second half. Haven't had a lot persevere through in this one. But here's an opportunity as Esquivel is going to quickly erase that. Squibb had to just beat Esquivel to have a one-on-one with the keeper, Megan Davidson, but unable to do so there, as now Nolte has it going the other way. Some fancy footwork as she tries to get past Giovanna Pedrosani. Gives it to Witt. Has it taken away. As now, once again, the defense gets it done for the Blue Jays. Witt ahead. Gets past the defender. Forces a save out of Mulhern-Guerre, and she answers the test.
It was a good almost shot cross there as she saw that Sanchez Strada was making that run into the box and was trying to almost cross her, but had enough power on it and would put it on goal for it to be be classified as a shot. It'd be really tough when you're a goalkeeper to recognize that situation and try and either intercept it or go for the save on the rebound shot.
Squibb back to Campos. Campos with some room to work with. This is where she's the most dangerous, but unable to get anything going as Sherelle Kent has checked back into the game as well for the Tigers. Ahead to Pedersani. As they say, it is last touched by Bogue. She thought the ball had already gone out, but she went to pick it up, and it'll be Westminster ball. Checking out now will be Karina Esquivel. She's had a very, very good game. And in for her comes Liz Hammond.
Yeah, definitely a solid day from Esquivel today on that back line. You can tell she's very attacking-minded as well. Made a lot of not only runs, but carries with the ball past her defensive line into the midfield to try and set up any sort of offense for Westminster, and really dual-minded player is all you can really ask for a center back in this sort of game with the possession of this lopsided.
In the 70th minute now, as once again Westminster tries to add on to this lead. But now Sherelle Kent. Melissa Cassana trying to clear it away, but kicks it out of bounds, and it'll be another throw in. And here comes Estrada, who just checked in. She'll keep possession. As it'll be another throw-in, deep. In fact, it'll be Wesleyan's throw-in, as they try to get the ball out of their territory. Here's Campos, unable to get by Kelsey Gordon. Ball goes out of bounds. It'll be a throw-in for the Tigers as they look for something to try to poke away at this 2-0 deficit that Westminster has them in.
Iowa Wesleyan almost looks a little bit more tired than they did in the first half. I mean, obviously that's going to happen when you're playing 90 minutes of soccer, but when you really are almost relying on a counterattack, it's, and you're this tired this late into the game, it's almost seems like it's unsalvageable when your players are not exactly so fit enough to keep making those runs in behind the Westminster defense that you so desperately need. They're not really testing Megan Davis, the goalkeeper of Westminster, at all.
And early on in this one, Wesleyan did have a few counterattacks that looked like they could be going somewhere and looked like they could have something in them, but those faded away rather quickly, and since then, there really hasn't been anything that's replaced those counters as the offensive go-to for this Tigers team. They've really not had any luck on that side at all, but to be fair, they haven't really had much possession on the offensive side of the field at all.
And a lot of the time in the first half, they were relying on the linkage play from Jacqueline Campos to really link play, to bring the ball from the defensive end to the offensive third, and she was the one making runs. She was the one really facilitating everything on offense, wearing number 9 and playing more of an attacking midfielder or central midfielder, more kind of a number 8 role for Iowa Wesleyan. But if she starts getting tired and Iowa Wesleyan has no one else to rely on, this game can get just out of reach for them if they lack the personnel.
They haven't had much in this second half, as Nulty tried to dribble and make something happen, but the dribble goes out of bounds for another goal kick. Two nothing, the Blue Jays on top, and what has been a very convincing performance for them so far today. Really not letting Iowa Wesleyan get anything going on either side of the ball. Just constant pressure, a lot of shots on goal, making Kylie Mulhern-Gier work. Very, very good performance all around for the Westminster Blue Jays in this one as they look to add on here. Here's Witt. Tries to cross it, nobody home. And it is corralled by Mulhern Gear once again.
And really, this day could be really categorized as a confidence booster for Westminster. They lost only on Saturday to Fort Bond in their opening game, 2-0. And they really seemed almost outmatched like they were in this game, or like they are doing to Iowa Wesleyan in that game compared to Fort Bond on Saturday. They don't play actually for another 7 days. They play next Tuesday at Greenville at 5 p.m. their third SWAC game of the week. If they can use the momentum from this day and work on it and build off of it, they can really have a nice day at Greenville next week.
And of course, that week going into a game feels a lot nicer when you're coming off of a win rather than having to wait a week to avenge a loss. As they are now in the 76th minute, 14 minutes away from victory is Westminster, and a two-goal lead to protect. Pedrasani. Try to play a little two-man game with Bogue, but the return pass is a little out of the reach.
Another substitution for Westminster now, and Schulte's coming back into the game, replacing Nolte, actually. Westminster only with four subs on the day, but definitely utilizing them well and rotating through the players to keep all their legs fresh on the field.
You have to say it's a very well-deserved rest for the freshman, Rachel Nolte. She has been all over the pitch today, doing a lot of things right. Didn't get a goal, but does have an assist to her name and created a lot of chances. Here's Frisella. Now to Gordon. Finds Bond. Excuse me, that's Liz Hammond. Also recently checking in. Gordon ahead to Estrada. Now to Schulte. But able to take it away from Kent is Hammond. Ahead to Witt. And another corner for Westminster now as Kasana will just kick it out of bounds, try to avoid any more pressure.
For most of the first half, we saw the ball was on the Iowa Wesleyan side of the pitch, but Iowa Wesleyan really had somewhat of a majority of possession, keeping control of it and passing it amongst their back line. What we've seen now is that the ball's still on the Iowa Wesleyan side of the pitch, but Westminster's the one dominating possession this entire half. It's an interesting trade-off at halftime.
Corner makes its way to Becca Bond, whose shot is deflected by Brower. And now it's Squibb ahead to Pedrasani. And now Westminster moves with it. Here's Estrada. Kicked out of bounds by Kent.
Two more substitutions for Westminster. Subbing back in the game. Trying to see him all the way on the far side. Excuse me. I believe Halmachek's also checking back into the game, taking off Kelsey Gordon. As well as a change over at left wing. I believe that's Witt coming off the field. Excuse me, Elson Witt coming off the field. Replacing for his added loss.
So the goal scorer, Gordon, will come off. Ooh, as a hard collision there between Bogue and Alsbury, but both players get up quickly. It'll be a free kick for Westminster.
Excuse me, sorry to interrupt you, but it's just a hard challenge as Bogue was coming in that ball hard. It was a sort of a weaker ball played across the midfield, almost flatly. right across the field. Boak thought she could intercept it, tried to go in hard, but just kind of collided there. So force a free kick here.
Free kick is just wide for Halamichek. She went for a goal, and just wide of the right post was that one. As we approach the 80th minute here, 10 minutes to go. Westminster still holding on to that 2-0 lead. Here's Bogue. Ahead to Squibb. Tries to find Avalos. But the ball is sent back. And on the run is Estrada trying to make something happen. Able to win possession for the Blue Jays. But now the back line getting the ball out of bounds. And it'll be another throw in for Westminster. Here's Beck into Estrada. Tried to find Kloss, but was unable to. Ball will go out of bounds now. Another Westminster throw-in.
Another Westminster substitution as well. Back coming back onto the field. We have Maddie Lake on the far side taking off Annalise Beck. So we're at a defensive midfielder position for Westminster, which they've been playing really well at all game. We're playing a 4-3-3 and really keep the ball well in the midfield of this Iowa Wesleyan side of the field. Both for Beck to keep, Lake to keep that possession stats up for Westminster coming here now, just under 10 minutes to go in this game as it's kind of become stagnant or so, but trying to break that stagnancy is Maddie Lawton.
Lawton came close once again, almost forcing a save out of Mulhern-Guerre, but it'll be another goal kick. As we approach, or get under, just 8 minutes left in this one. As Westminster hopes to hold on for its first win of the year and its first home game of the season. But 7.5 minutes, plus maybe some stoppage time to go for that. As Campos tried to find Avalos, cutting. But it's picked off, another good defensive performance. But this might be the opportunity, could it be, as Squibb is called offside. So it will not.
The flag is raised for either team all game. It's really interesting, especially because Westminster has been playing more of a dumping technique or dumping tactics to dump the ball over the back line of Iowa Wesleyan half here. Speed run onto the ball. Iowa Wesleyan is trying to really build up play and try to back into Westminster on their defensive line. It's been really interesting not really seeing that flag raise all day except for coming only in the 84th minute here.
Is there some good work there by Kloss to keep the ball in play and get a shot opportunity for Becca Bond as it goes wide and another goal kick once again for Wesleyan.
Good read right there from Bond to recognize the ball coming across there and make that run to get a one-touch shot onto it. She was a little off balance though on her right foot, getting her left foot around that. Could have ended up in a better shot result from Bond, but a lot of players seem to favor their stronger foot or so. And it's the trade-off you really have to do with. You're either going to get your stronger foot on it or have an off-balance shot.
Another throw-in for Westminster. That has been the phrase of the day. As now Schulte wins it back before giving it away once again. Here come the Blue Jays. As that one goes off of Estrada and to Schulte. Scored the second goal of the game just before halftime. And she'll win another throw-in off of Caitlin Denny.
We were really expecting it. We were kind of talking at halftime, given that Westminster got two goals really late in the first half. So Iowa Wesleyan really to come out stronger in that second half to try and go for the tie here. And that would really kind of open them up, and maybe Westminster could exploit that a little more. But Iowa Wesleyan has really kept their same game plan of sticking deep with their defensive line and really their entire team to play a low block. And when they do that, they're not really getting the opportunities. I don't think they've had a shot on goal so far this entire second half.
And it's got to be a little bit surprising, right, for them not to change up the strategy at all, especially since, you know, it didn't work too well in the first half as Schulte checks out once again for Montana. Under 5 minutes now here in regulation. Ahead to Rios. Now it's Allsbury, just out of the reach of Kloss. And now it'll be another corner as Ingrid Lima just kicks it out of bounds.
So we are still putting about seven players in and around the box to try and get that third goal. Only putting two players back. Which Iowa Wesleyan matches with two of their own. So Iowa Wesleyan definitely couldn't have a counterattack opportunity if Westminster put this many players in the box trying to go for a third goal.
Off the head of Lima. And out of the box now. As Lawton tried to put a boot on it from about 25 yards out. Here's Halimacek. Now to Montana. Cleared away and up to Avalos. Now Brower. Back to Bogue and out of the reach of Campos. Here's Halimacek, has it taken away. Now up to Squibb. Taken away by Bond. Now to Lawton. Brower to Avalos. Back to Lenk, who leaves it for Allsbury. Making the run is Estrada, but she can't get there in time. As Estrada will be called for offside with just under 2 minutes left as we are now in minute number 89.
Yeah, Westminster not doing too much to test the back line of Iowa Wesleyan so far a little lately, or even the goalkeeper Mohan Griar, standing over the ball. Now lately, it is just their trust trying to almost pass it around. Not putting those balls in behind with the speed they had as they were earlier in the game. Maybe it's because they're a little tired as well, or the game plan is just a little changed to try and keep possession of it here. But as we're nearing just about the final 70 seconds or so of this game, looks like Westminster is going to pull out the win here. Unless Iowa Wesleyan can do something with the possession they had. But it's a good result today for Westminster, going 1-1 on the season right now.
And I'd say it's a, excuse me, I'd say it's a, an incredibly deserved result today as well. I mean, they were clearly the better team for all 90 minutes. They started the game with pushing the pace, and they never really backed down on it. I'd say this, there were, it was a tale of two teams out here today, and the team that came out on top in Westminster was a team that deserved to do so, Will.
I think so. They definitely held the possession stat all game and stuck to their tactics well. They adjusted their tactics to beat Iowa Wesleyans as opposed to the contrary, and really used the options they had. They relied on the speed of their attackers, like we're seeing right here from Estrada trying to get to it, but getting called for a foul, actually. Only, but, excuse me, that was at Muller and Greer getting called for the foul as the clock didn't stop, or maybe not. Referee puts 2 seconds left on the clock as he calls for a stoppage of play after the foul called against Muller and Greer, who has yet to get up.
And now that
you want to see for a goalkeeper in the final 2 seconds of the game when a free kick is coming out only 20 yards out.
And especially, you know, with, just with that 2 seconds, there's, it's not enough time for anything to happen that of importance. So you really don't like to see Moringier go down with virtually no time left, especially after, you know, a good performance by her given how many shots she had to face.
And I honestly don't love this decision made by the center referee, TJ Higgins, when the game is practically over. Even though the foul was committed, even though necessarily it was a foul and deserves to be a free kick in the final 2 seconds of a game, the keeper is very clearly hurt. They're going to have to warm up and bring a new keeper on to the field just to play his final 2 seconds of a game and give a free kick to a team that's already 2-0 up. It's not the greatest scenario. Maybe they might just take Mohan Greer off the field and play with 10 men for the final 2 seconds or so and put one of their field players in goal, but this just really brings a halt to this game where the game should be halted due to time already.
And it's kind of a sour note for this game to end on as well. I mean, you see just a bad injury, or hopefully not so bad, but what looks to be something not so good happened to Kylie Moringier, you know, on the last play of the game, essentially. And, you know, like we've been saying, Will, in a time of the game where, you know, the result is pretty much all but determined, and the free kick is going to happen, I guess, because rules are rules, but it's tough to see, you know, a game end in this kind of fashion with a player down on the ground being attended to, and it looks like she's getting up on her own power. Hopefully she can stay there, but it's not looking good.
You see the Mets team all on the sideline on the far side. They'll play what was scheduled to be 7 o'clock, and they'll probably give a little bit of warm-up time to the Mets team, but they're still waiting to even get on the field to warm up to continue. So really this just delays that even more, as it looks like Mohan Greer is going to stay on the field, hobble to back to her own goal to attempt to save this free kick. If I'm Westminster, I don't even put it on target.
I would just kick it and run the clock out, I'd assume. And that would, I think, be the sportsman-like thing to do. And we'll see what happens here, but you never know. It's hard to pass up an opportunity to bend it like Beckham.
Westminster with 2 players on the goal line, one of them on Mohan Greer. As it's interesting from Iowa Wesleyan to hold their line on that back line, not to have a few defenders a couple yards up inside the box to try and catch Westminster offside, but they're really just crowding the box all around Mohan Greer right there.
Halimacek will take it.
Put it on target.
And it almost gets in. It's off the face of a player, and now she is down. So that is not something you like to see. Not a great ending to this one, but the result is a good one for Westminster. They win the game by a score of 2-0. A very dominant performance. Kelsey Gordon with the goal. Natalie Schulte with the goal. 2-0, your final score. Will, your final thoughts?
Yeah, it was a good day today for Westminster. Played really good soccer, especially in that first half, especially in the latter half of that first half, to get 2 fantastic goals running in behind on the counterattack. 2 goals coming from Kelsey Gordon first, and then a great solo goal coming, from Natalie Schulte. And got the two goals they needed to win the day, and great defense effort in the second half led to the victory today for Westminster. They play Greenville in a week, next Tuesday, away at 5 p.m. Next up is the men's game between Iowa Wesleyan and Westminster here at Mueller Stadium.
And you'll be on the call for that one. I will be as well. We'll be trading places. You won't want to miss that one. The second part of our doubleheader between Iowa Wesleyan and Westminster coming up next. The final from the first one, 2-0 in favor of the Blue Jays.